हेलो एवरीवन, टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट आवर नेक्स्ट लेक्चर, दैट इज आवर इंटरनेट ऑफ थिंग्स एंड मशीन टू मशीन, यू कैन से मशीन टू मशीन कम्युनिकेशन। इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट व्हाट इज द मीनिंग ऑफ मशीन टू मशीन, व्हिच प्रोटोकॉल्स आर यूज्ड फॉर मशीन टू मशीन कम्युनिकेशन, व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन IoT एंड मशीन टू मशीन। In the previous lecture, we already discussed about the actuators and the sensors. So, actually, in this machine, here the machine means these sensors and the actuators. This first machine word meaning is, it is consist of those sensors and actuators which we already studied in the previous lecture. So, machine to machine refers the networking of machines for the purpose of remote monitoring and control and data exchange. So, machine to machine means the fully automatic system in which there is no human intervention while devices are communicating end to end. So, here this consists of three words. First machine, second two, third one is machine. So, I already told you this machine refers to the sensors or actuators that is monitoring or actuating in uplink or the downlink, and two consist of the network that is used or that is responsible for end-to-end communication. And this next machine word meaning is it consists of those devices that is responsible for processing the gathered information or the application devices are comes into this machine word. So this machine to machine word basically invented or origin by the Nokia family in 2002. So basically this Nokia M2M platform family, it consists of the gateway software, it consists of 31 GSM connectivity terminal and application development kit, and combinedly this system is called the Nokia M2M machine to machine platform family. So the Nokia is the company which first originated this term machine to machine. So basically this figure shows the end to end communication or end to end architecture of one machine to machine system. It consists of machine to machine area network and the core network, gateway and the application. So basically this machine to machine area network consists of machine nodes. These are our nodes, fine, and all these nodes have some embedded hardware that is used for the sensing, actuation and the communication purpose, and the various communication protocols are used in this machine to machine area network. So various communication protocols, for example ZigBee, Bluetooth, Modbus, MBUS, wireless or PLC, power line communication, 6LoWPAN, IEEE 802.15.4, etc. So these are some protocols which are used in this machine to machine or M2M local area network, which are responsible for communicating the information. And this communication link, also called the M2M core network. So it provides the connectivity to remote M2M area networks, fine. So this communication network may be the wired network or may be the wireless network, fine. So this is our wired network and this is our wireless network. While in the machine to machine area network, so in this network all these Networks consist of our known IP-based communication protocols. Fine, while in the wireless network, the IP-based protocols are used. So, if this network want to communicate with some external network, fine, this one want to communicate with two, because in the one all are wired network or the known IP-based communication protocols, so we have to use this M2M gateway to communicate this area network with some external network. For that, these gateway are responsible for that communication. And the next component of this system consists of this M2M applications. I already told you this communication networks may be the wired network or the wireless network. So in the wired network, basically the Ethernet optics are the examples of this wired network. It means the dedicated cabling is used between the sensors and the gateway. So the pros of this wired network are these are very reliable, very fast rate, small delay, or the secure. Security is also high in the wired network. While the cons of this wired network is it is expensive to roll out. Fine, also the area, or in other words, we can say these are not scalable, and these are not mobile in nature. Means if we want to move these wired networks from one particular place to some other place, then it is very difficult. Fine, so these are some cons of this wired network. Next one is our wireless network. So basically there are two type of wireless network. One is the capillary, second one is the cellular wire network. So in the subsequent slides, we will discuss about this capillary and the cellular wireless networks in detail. So the examples of our capillary network is WLAN, BLE, ZigBee, etc. Fine. And the pros of this wireless network are these are cheap to roll out and these are generally scalable in nature. Fine. And these have the low power consumption. So these are some pros of this wireless network, this capillary network basically particular. And the cons is it is short range in nature, low rates, means within one building we can use this capillary based the network. Fine, also the there have the weaker security as compared to over the wired network, and also there is chance of the interference. Fine, or this is lack of universal infrastructure and the coverage. These are some disadvantages of this capillary wireless network. So this is one, this figure is basically one example of this capillary wireless network, and this is over the wired network. And next is our cellular wireless network. So you know, in all your mobile phones, smartphones, now the 4G is used. Fine, in the next some years 5G can be used in our India. So these are some examples of our cellular wireless network like 3G, 4G, 5G, LTE, WiMAX, etc. The advantage or the pros of these cellular networks are these are excellent coverage, mobility, means they are mobile in nature. We can use our mobile in at any location. Fine. Also the roaming, generally secure, and the infrastructure. Fine. And the cons of the cellular wireless network is these are very expensive in nature, and also the cost required for the maintenance is also high. These are not power efficient, and there is some delay in that, means they are not so much fast in nature. Fine. So these are some advantages and disadvantages of wired and the wireless network. So I already told you the M2M gateway is responsible to communicate one M2M area network with some external network. Fine, because the nodes in M2M area networks are known IP, used known IP protocols. Fine. So, if one M2M area network want to communicate with some external network, then in between we need these gateways. Fine. If this is one network, this M2M area network want to communicate with some external network, then this in between this gateway is used. So the communication between the M2M nodes and the M2M gateway is based on the communication protocols which are native to the M2M area network. Fine. So this native protocol is used to communicate between the M2M node and the gateway. So this M2M gateway basically performs the protocol translation to enable IP connectivity for M2M area networks, because you know in the M2M area networks these are non-IP based protocols. So this protocol's translation in M2M gateway is used to translate from non-IP protocols to the IP based protocols. Fine. And also these M2M gateways act as the proxy performing translation from or to native protocols. Fine. To and from internet protocols. Fine. So this proxy is performing translation from these native protocols, from to these native protocols, and here from this IP to the native protocols. Fine, like this way and the like this way. So to and from this native protocols to the IP protocols, and from IP protocols to the native protocols. Fine. So within this M2M gateway, each node in machine-to-machine area networks appeared as the virtualized node for the external machine-to-machine area network. So this is the whole working of this M2M gateway. Next, the difference between IoT and the machine-to-machine or M2M. Basically, both these IoT and M2M use the networking of the machines or the devices, but there is a difference in their underlying technologies, system architecture, and the type of the application. So, first difference lies in its communication protocol. So, basically, machine to machine and IoT can differ how the communication between the machine and devices happens. So we know the machine to machine use either proprietary or the non-IP based communication protocols for the communication within the machine to machine area network. Means within our machine to machine area networks, all the devices are connected with the help of our non-IP based protocols. So basically in our machine to machine communication, the machine-to-machine protocols used here is over this ZigBee, Bluetooth, Modbus, PLAN, 6LO, WPAN, IEEE 802.15.4, this Wi-Fi, this 802.3 Internet, 802.165 Max. Basically, all these protocols lies within the link layer, that is below the network layer, as shown in this figure. While in the IoT, all these protocols that is responsible for the communication, such as HTTP, COAP, WebSockets, MQTT, XMPP, DDS, AMQP, are lies in the above the transport layer. Fine. So the focus of communication in IoT is usually on the protocols that is above, basically over the network layer. Fine. And in our M2M, these protocols basically lies the below the network layer. The second difference is basically in the IoT, the things refers to our physical objects that have the unique identifier and can sense and communicate with their external environment or their physical states. Means the unique identifiers basically in our IoT is the IP based, while in the machine to machine system, these all the devices or machines consist of homogeneous types. Fine. Within the machine to machine area network, while in the IoT we can use the heterogeneous type of devices or the machines, like the a number of sensors can be used that are different in the nature. For examples, in the home automation system, different type of nodes or different types of sensors are used in over the IoT. Fine. And also in our machine to machine or machine to machine area network, these machines are connected with each other with the help of the known IP based communication protocols, while in the IoT that these devices can be connected with the IP based protocols. And these devices are the homogeneous in nature in the M2M system, while these are the heterogeneous in nature in over the IoT system. Third difference is basically the over machine to machine is more emphasis on the hardware module, while in the IoT there is a more emphasis on the software module. So basically in the IoT devices can run the specialized software for the sensor data collection, data analytics and the interfacing with the cloud through IP based the communication. Fine. While in the M2M these are more emphasis or more focus on the hardware module. Next difference is in their data collection and the analysis. So M2M data is collected in the point solutions and often in the on-premises storage infrastructure, while in the IoT data is collected in the cloud server or on the cloud, and that cloud may be the public, private or the hybrid cloud. So the analytics component analyze the data, stores the result on the cloud database. So this is the also the main difference between our IoT and the M2M. So in terms of application, basically the machine to machine data is collected, we know, at the point solution in the on-premises storage infrastructure and can be accessed by the on-premise application such as the diagnosis application, service management application or the on-premises or enterprise applications, while the IoT data is collected on the cloud and can be accessed by our cloud application such as the our analytics application, enterprise application, remote diagnosis and the management applications. Basically in our IoT the data we can access through the cloud. Fine. So basically the scale of data collected in the IoT are so massive, and the cloud based real time and the batch data analytics frameworks can be used for the data analysis, because the data is stored on the cloud and at any location, from any location and for any remote application we can use or process that data for specific applications. Next is our general challenges in M2M. Basically, there are various challenges for the M2M systems. First is basically the design for the huge number of devices. If we increase the huge number of machines or the devices, the complexity increases, and this is our one of the challenges in our M2M system. Second one is the reduction of our control signaling. Third one is optimization for low data transmission. Then next, cost reduction, also the one important challenge in M2M system. Then congestion control algorithms, load distribution and the balancing, and security, also the one of the major challenge in M2M system, and the traffic models, etc. So these are some general challenges in M2M systems. Now we will discuss these two type of our wireless network. One is our capillary wireless network, second one is our cellular M2M. Fine. So basically this capillary M2M is mostly the embedded design. It is low power and low cost designs, and it is useful for the short range communication. system. Fine. So the M2M or machine to machine will be dominated by industry driven standardized low power solution, and one of the this IEEE 802.11ah is basically our wireless local area network WLAN technology, or it is the protocol of the WLAN, and it is one of the solution for this low power systems. Fine. So in basically the capillary M2M, each node basically consists of four elements. One is our sensor, then radio chip, microcontroller, and the energy supply. So these are four basic elements of capillary M2M. And the target for any M2M system is that should be the low cost, and complexity is also low, small in size, and the energy consumption or power consumption also should be low. Now the basic problems arises in capillary M2M is basically the interference problem and the fading problem arises in capillary M2M network. Also there are different vendors which have different characteristics, different in operability between these devices. And also one major problem is that is the scalability. So these are some major problems in our capillary M2M. So basically this figure shows one capillary M2M systems, that is our Zigbee. Fine. It also contains all these four components. This is our chip, microcontroller, fine, and the energy supply. So these are some basic elements that are required for this capillary M2M system. Next is cellular M2M. So this LTE is basically the example of our cellular M2M. So this LTE is basically the long-term evaluation. So there are three versions of this LTE: long-term evaluation, this LTEA, and this LTEA Pro. Now the some advantages of our cellular M2M is basically the capillary network provides only the local coverage, while our cellular network provides the ubiquitous coverage and global connectivity. Fine. Means the coverage is nearly same in that particular covered area. Fine. And in the capillary M2M, basically the mobility end, there is a high speed data transmission, and also the interference problem that arises in this capillary M2M can be managed in our cellular M2M system. While our capillary M2M systems are basically used for short range communication system, while our cellular M2M are used for the wide range network or wide range systems. So the main challenges of our cellular M2M is, so the high costs and the complexity is also high. Second one is human to human expectations. As the technology is advanced, going advanced, then the expectation of humans are also increasing. That's why several times or after several periods there is a need to modify all these cellular networks or cellular systems. Also the new market requires new way of thinking in cellular M2M system. So these are some challenges for the operators in cellular M2M system. Also actually there are some problems in the current cellular system that are designed for human to human. So basically there is some delay in our voice connections also. This is our major like problem in current cellular system. Also the cost is also high. Sometimes we have to recharge our mobiles daily for the internet and for other things. Also we like to download a lot, mainly the high bandwidth data. Fine. So to tackle all these issues, the new paradigm that is the number of nodes in the cellular M2M is increased day by day. Also, the applications are delay intolerant. Also, that delay, the network providers are also minimizing that delay. And also, the nodes need to operate autonomously for a long time. So these are some new paradigm in this cellular machine-to-machine system. Wi-Fi for the sensors. I already told you this IEEE 802.11ah is WLAN technology. This is basically your Wi-Fi protocol for our sensors. So this IEEE 802.11ah use cases for the target low rate and the low or the long range applications, basically for the sensors, automation and the metrics. So this Wi-Fi is used for our sensors basically, or the actuators. Fine. So in this, battery operated devices should limit the power consumptions. Fine. Basically in any system, the power consumption should be as low as the possible. So here in this system, why power can be reduced? By limiting the packet transmission or by limiting the wake or the receive time. Fine. Also, these listening for the backgrounds or traffic information maps also consumes the power. So basically our backend is a link, these backends is a like a light system. Fine. So it repeatedly transmits a steady signal that can be received by the various devices. So it is basically over the lighthouse. It continuously generates some signal and that the devices at other nodes continuously receive this signal. So also some power is consumed in this process. Fine. So we need to, there are various things we need to improve in this wireless M2M system. That is our delay. We have to minimize the delay. We have to minimize the power consumptions. Also, we have to minimize the cost. Also, we have to increase or we have to modify the technology time to time to meet the expectations of humans. So these are major challenges in our wireless M2M system. Also, I already told you there are these different challenges in this capillary community and the cellular community. So the capillary community, this reliability is one of the challenge, delay I already told you, infrastructure also one of the challenge, standards also one of the challenge, and the range. So these are some challenges in our capillary systems. And for the cellular community, the power, delay, application specific, like for particular humans that want to use that one particular application, for that one particular application we have to improve over the cellular system. Fine. Also the rate and the number of the nodes. So these are some challenges for our cellular community. SDN. So this is basically a software defined networking. So previously that in the conventional layer network, these data layers, so basically this is the diagram, this is the figure for this convolutional layer network CLN, and this is the diagram for the software defined the networking. So in the CLN, these data layer and the control layer, fine, are merged in one router. Fine. Both these layers are merged in the router, while in this SDN there is a separate this data layer and there is a separate this the control unit. This is control unit, this is the data layer. So both are separated from the each other. While in the convolutional layer network, this data plane or the control plane are merged in the router or the switch. Fine. So in the SDN, basically the controller maintain a unified view of the network. Fine. So in this control unit, there is a SDN controller that maintains a unified view of the network and make the configuration management and provisioning is simpler. Fine. So basically in the SDN uses the simple packet forwarding hardware. Fine. While in this CLN, there is a specialized hardware. Fine. So this is also one difference in this SDN and the CLN. Fine. So basically the control part, this is our control part. So control part or the control plane is a part of network. Basically in this control plane, all these signaling and the routing message traffic, fine, all the signaling schemes or the message traffic routing schemes are included in this, the control part. Why? This data plane is a part of network that carries the payload data traffic. Fine. In this data planes, all the payload data traffic are included in this data plane. Fine. So the basic limitations of our convolutional network is, first limitation is over the complex network device. This is one limitation of our CLN. And the second limitation is basically the management overhead. It is difficult to manage the CLN. And the third basic this limitation is over the scalability. Fine. So these are major limitations in our CLN that can be removed by the software defined networking. Fine. So in basically the software defined networking, there are three basically layer. One is our application layer, second one is our control layer, third one is our data layer. So this is our application layer, this is our control layer, and this is our the infrastructure layer or the data layer. Fine. So basically the application layer, this application layer helps to simplify the network by introducing a well established link between the control unit and the received data. Fine. So basically with the help of this API application specific interface, this application layer can receive the data from this control layer. Fine. So basically this application layer communicates with the control layer with the help of this northbound open API. So basically there are two type of API. One is northbound open API, second one is the southbound open API. In the northbound open API, basically the upper layer can communicate with the lower layer, while the southbound open API means the lower layer can communicate with the upper layer. So for this application layer, with the help of northbound API, this application layer can communicate with this control layer. Fine. So in the control layer, basically this control layer help to build up logic based controlling signal to control the networking devices by analyzing the information received from the application layer. Fine. So by this information provided by the application layer, this control layer basically controls all the logic based controlling signals. Fine. With the help of this logic based controlling signals, it can control all the networking devices. So these are the networking devices that can be connect with this control layer. Fine. Next one is our, also one more information about the control layer is this, it also has the ability to pass the information from the data layer to the application layer. Means this data layer, it can pass the information from this data layer to directly this the application layer. Fine. So it can communicate, it can this control layer can take the data from here, also it can take the data from here and pass this data to the application layer. So sometimes we are saying it is the bidirectional nature, or it is basically used for the bidirectional flow of the information. Fine. So third one is our basically the data layer. This is our data layer. Fine. So in the data layer, this data layer helps to forward traffic according to the logic it received from the control layer. Fine. So this data layer received the logic from this control layer and send this information to the devices accordingly. Fine. So after receiving the data from the network, this layer processes the information and pass it to the application layer. First, it receives the data from this control layer. So as per the control layer, it will send the information to the application. Fine. So these are the three layers used in the SDN, software defined networking. So there are three elements in this software defined networking. One is our centralized network controller. Second one is programmable open API. Fine. Third one is our standard communication interface. So first one is basically over this one. Fine. Second one is this API, and third one is basically this. Fine. So these are three main key elements of the SDN. So first is centralized network controller. So with decoupled control and data planes, the centralized network controller, the network administrator basically can rapidly configure the network with the help of this centralized network controller. Fine. So basically this SDN application can be deployed through the programmable open APIs. Fine. So this programmable API, this open API, basically the interface between the SDN application and the controlling layer. This SDN applications and this controlling layer is basically interfaced with the help of this application specific interface, this API. These are the northbound open API, I already told you. Next one is basically this SDN architecture uses a standard communication interface between the control and the infrastructure layer. So basically this API. Fine. So here in the SDN, basically the first one example of this is OpenFlow. Fine. So OpenFlow is basically API which is defined by the Open Networking Foundations, and it is broadly accepted SDN protocols for the southbound interface. Fine. I already told you the meaning of northbound interface and the southbound interface. So these are basically three main elements in the software defined networking. Next is our NFV. NFV means the network function virtualization. Basically, this is a technology by which all the physically present network functions can be converted to the virtualized form. So in other words, basically this NFV is a technology that leverages virtualization to consolidate the heterogeneous network devices onto the industry standard high volume servers, switches and the storage. Means the various heterogeneous networks are converted to the virtualized network. So basically this is NFV is complementary to the SDN, and the work and the function of NFV is only to provide the infrastructure on which our SDN can run. So basically these NFV and SDN are mutually benefited to each other, but they are not dependent. Fine. So the network functions can be virtualized without the SDN. Similarly, SDN also can run without the NFV. Fine. So the NFV, main function of NFV is only to provide the infrastructure, or we can say the only to provide the virtualized infrastructure on which this SDN can run. So both these technology, or both these NFV and SDN, are independent on each other. So in other words, we can say NFV is only the complementary to the SDN. So basically there are three key elements of the NFV. First is virtualized network functions. It is also called the VNF. Second one is our NFV infrastructure. Third one is our NFV management and the orchestration. So basically, the virtualized network functions, VNF, is a software implementation of a network functions which is capable of running over the NFV infrastructure. So in this VNF, all the network functions are converted into a software, and that software can run onto the NFV infrastructure. Fine. And also the NFV infrastructure, or sometimes also in short form we are saying NFVI. Basically, in this NFVI, all there are two things in it. One is the virtualization layer. In the work of virtualization layer is to compute network and the storage, to convert these functions, these three functions, compute, network and the storage, into the virtualized or the virtual compute, virtual network or the virtual storage, means converting of all these functions into these virtualized forms. So this is the main function of this NFVI or the network function virtualization architecture. Third one is our NFV management and the orchestration. So this is third main or key element of our NFV. So actually, this NFV management and orchestration focuses on all virtualization specific management tasks. All the management tasks are included in this, basically we can say, in this element. Fine. And it also covers the orchestration and lifecycle management of physical or the software resources that supports the infrastructure virtualization, means all the software part that supports this NFV infrastructure, that lifetime, all these functions are handled by this NFV management or the orchestration, means all the management related functions are handled in this. Fine. So this is the main aim of our NFV, is to virtualize the things. Now we will understand this thing with one simple examples of your home architecture, home network architecture. You know, in your home network architecture, basically all these functions, so we can say our laptop, this is our laptop, light or window or door. Fine. So these are connected with the, or this we can say, one board with microcontroller, right? And this washer and the refrigerator. So these are some general appliances of our home. Fine. For our smart home. Fine. So all these functions are connected with the help of our network gateway. What is the use of this network gateway? Basically, all these function or all these high-end devices basically are over the non-IP based. So basically, this home gateway provides one particular IP to this particular device. So all these are connected with this. So this is also connected with this. This is also connected with this network gateway. Also, this IPTV, or we can say the VoIP phone, also can be connected to this network gateway. Fine. So in this, basically what happened, now these NFV can be used to virtualize all these things. Fine. So this gateway, the main function of this gateway is the routing capability and translates this private IP address to the public address. So basically, this is our public network. So this is our public network, which consists of various nodes which are connected to each other, and this is our internet. This is IPTV. This is our VoIP. Fine. All these are on the clouds basically. So the function of this gateway is to provide the application specific, this gateway provides the application specific routing for applications such as IPTV, VoIP. Fine. So this converts this private IP to the public network. Fine. So this is basically known NFV based network. Fine. So what is the use of NFV here? This NFV can virtualize all the things. If we use the NFV in this system, then what this NFV can done, or the how the virtualization, all these things like our laptops and lights, this door, windows, which are connected in previously with the help of our gateways, now these are connected with the help of microcontroller, and these are directly connected to this gateway in the previous examples. Fine. Now this gateway is replaced with the help of virtualized home gateway. Fine. This virtualized home gateway, which controls all the functions, and this virtualized gate, this home gateway and this NFV architecture basically provides a switch or the wireless access point in the home. Fine. The wireless access point, the job of this wireless access point is to connect all these things. Fine. And this is VoIP and IPTV, to connect all these things, and with the help of this wireless technology, these things are controlled by this virtualized home gateway or this NFV architecture. Fine. In this technology, no gateway is needed, so all these functions can be controlled with the help of this virtualized home gateway. Fine. So this is the one simple example of our NFV network function virtualization. All the gateway functions that is used to the route from this local IP to the this public network, that all functions can be done with the help of this virtualized home gateway. Fine. This NFV architecture or this NFV architecture provides basically the access point or the switches, and these switches are basically the wireless that can control or that can send the information related to this high-end devices to this cloud, and this cloud basically controls all these functions with the help of this virtualized home gateway. This is one simple example of this NFV. So this is all about the M2M and the IoT. So in this lecture, we studied about the basics of M2M, the basic difference between IoT and the M2M. We also discussed about the capillary and the cellular M2M, and what is the difference between this capillary and M2M, their advantages, disadvantages, and what is the SDN and NFV. So we already discussed about this our software defined networking and over the NFV part, network function virtualization, with the help of one examples, and what is the difference between SDN and the NFV. So all these things we discussed in this lecture. So thank you for your kind attention. So if you have any query regarding this lecture, then you can send me a mail. So thank you for your kind attention.